Great to see you all on Tuesday morning. Welcome to my vineyard ramble. And just look at those lovely colours. I've been just standing here taking photos because it's just like when you talk about, oh, hi, mum and dad. When you talk about that colour, burnt orange, it really is a lovely burnt orange. And the drive down here this morning was fabulous. So what I'm going to suggest is if you stay with me, we'll get in the Diane, you can see the Diane down there, and we'll hop in that on the way back and we'll just drive through this sea of lovely burnt orange, yellow, amber vines. So I look forward to that a little bit later on. But where are we? So let's just get our bearings here this morning. So right opposite me, I have the Toche Mountain. So I'm opposite the Toche Mountain. That's a lovely limestone massive that rises to about 900 meters. So up to 900 meters here. We've been on vineyards like the Caun opposite on there. And then we just pan round a little bit, and here just in the little dip there's a lovely limestone gorge, and that goes through to the little villages of Padern and then on to Cucugnan, if anybody has been to Cucugnan. Morning Julia, good to see you in Bordeaux. So Cucugnan through there, I make wonderful bread in Cucugnan, and then panning round you can just pick out perhaps Paziol is behind here. And then if I pan round, it's a little bit of Garrigue. Behind these bushes would be the Roussillon. So the Roussillon, that direction. The sun is just coming out behind the clouds. It is meant to be a lovely day today, but unfortunately it's still a little bit cloudy. And then panning round, we've got the mountains. Behind here is Vingros. And then that goes on to reefs out and onto the coast on the Roussillon, and then pan round a little bit and there we have in the distance the wonderful Chateau d'Aguilar. Looks absolutely magnificent this morning. It's probably just a little pin dot on the screen, but it is there in the background. Behind that we have Narbonne. So Narbonne, about an hour's drive from Touchon, where I'm here. And then panning round we have, you see, there's a clump of trees, and then just behind to the left of the trees, there's a little hill. That's where we were the other day when Jean-Marc was preparing the land for planting some more Syrah on the side of the hill. And that's where the rock is. If you remember my rock tastings that I did in the summer, they were on that little hill over there. And then Touchon in the foreground. So Touchon, just 900 people. Touchon, easy to say. When you're going to come down and see me, it's just number two and Shon, like the sun shone. So where are we? We haven't actually said where we are. Look at the lovely colours should give it away of what great variety that is. But here I have my handy little tea towel out here, and we're going to have a look where we are. This morning we are here, La Roque. So, La Roque Vineyard, for those of you who've got your tea towels out. I don't know if it's Kate Sweet. Kate, are you on today? Now, this I'm visiting this vineyard because Kate bought a bottle of my Carignan Gris not so long ago. And I said, oh, I know, I will do a ramble from the Carignan Gris vineyard. So this is my Carignan Gris little vineyard. So let's not forget the tea towel, and let's just have a little ramble back to the car and then a drive. We're going to have a drive through just this wonderful, wonderful colours this morning. So, oh, you are there, Kate. That's good. So this is the Carignan Gris. Morning, Carignan Gris. Now, these vines are about 70 years old. Carignan Gris, you may never have tasted that great variety individually, and that's because it's so rare. It really, really is very unusual to have it as 100% Carignan Gris. So the Carignan Gris, if you Google it, it says there's only 1 hectare in the whole world. That's how rare this great variety is. And we were just very lucky. Somebody actually included this little parcel when we bought some other vines, a Carignan Gris. And up until 2017, this great variety didn't really exist. It wasn't recognised as an official grape variety. That changed in 2017. But why is it so unpopular? Basically, it's really difficult temperamental grape variety because it ripens really late. So this is, it's a white grape, it's a lovely pink colour. We may get to see some of the lovely pink grapes that have been left behind. Lovely pink colour, but it does ripen really, really late on. So it actually ripens after most of the red grapes. And that, if you're in a cooperative system, it's really difficult to be able to manage because you've picked all your white grapes and then you have to go back, pick the reds, and then go back and pick white again. And the co-op is just not, it's not going to stay open while your Carignan Gris grapes ripen. So a lot of it has been ripped up or it's mixed in with other grapes. But it's when it's actually picked, just to make sure that the alcohol level is high enough if you're in the cooperative. So that's why it's very unusual. You were rationed to one bottle only. That's how rare it is, Kate. It really is unusual. And then the taste of it, I'll just show you. There's some little grappillon. Quite interesting in this vineyard. Remember now, we're looking at the yellow leaves are Grenache. And then at the back, you can see some lovely burnt orange colour. So they're the Carignan. So here, it's actually a little bit mixed up because this is a Grenache vine, and you can see here just some grappillon. We have the little grappillon there. So these grappillon, you can see the lovely colour. They're sort of a lovely pinky, greyy colour, hence the word Carignan Gris. And the style of the wine, I don't know, Kate, if you're there, you could perhaps put a little description if you've tasted it. I think you've tasted it already. But I find it quite savoury. It's quite a savoury wine, so it does go really well with like mushroom risotto, truffles, if you like truffles as well. That style of food, it is really quite unique, but must say the all-time favourite dish with Carignan Gris is cabbage. Did you try that, Kate? Some cabbage. And I do this like stuffed cabbage. Oh, look who's been in here. So they haven't done too much damage in this vineyard. They haven't turfed up the soil too much. You can see it's quite heavy, clayey soil because we're on the bottom, on the valley bottom. Just look at the colours. But stuffed cabbage, yeah, lovely recipe where you stuff cabbage leaves and then it's oven baked. And that goes extremely well with Carignan Gris. So if any of you are thinking of making some, you like cabbage dishes, then this is a perfect cabbage wine. Not very exotic, but it does work really well. Look at the colour of these leaves. So this, a typical Carignan vine, and you can see the darker Sarment. And then next to it, we have a Grenache. It's actually a Grenache Gris. So again, still mixed up. I think this vineyard, about a third of it is Carignan Gris, so it's not all Carignan Gris. Now, impossible to tell what colour the Carignan is unless you have a bunch of grapes left like this one. So here we have some Carignan, some red Carignan. So I'm walking back to the car so that we can just have a quick drive through the, just look at the colours this morning. Cabbage and Carignan, yeah, the wine lane, it does go really, really well. And something, I don't know if my cousin Robin is on this morning, but do you remember last time I was talking to you about the distillery and we were talking about Mark and Lee, the byproducts that we get from winemaking? I actually made a little mistake, which led me to read up on it. It was actually quite interesting. I said that they distilled an alcohol that was 94, I need to get this the right way around, that was 94 proof. What I actually meant was 94% alcohol, which is about 156 proof. Now I had a look up, I read up on it because I hadn't realized the difference between proof and alcohol. So proof was set up in the UK. It's actually a way of measuring alcohol so that alcohol could be taxed. So it's mainly spirits. And the way they worked it out was they mixed alcohol with gunpowder. I'll get there in the end. Oh, I'm going to walk back up here. Look at the cloud coming in. So they mixed alcohol with gunpowder, and when that gunpowder alcohol mix lit, that was what was called proof, 100 proof. So when it lit and you got a nice clear flame, that was 100 proof, and it was about 56% alcohol. So I learned that, and that's how they taxed it. But then I thought, well, I said to Jean-Marc, I was just trying to explain it to Jean-Marc, and he was like, what are you talking about, Katie? And in actual fact, in France, that does not exist. Proof is the same as alcohol. So when you say 50% alcohol, it's 50 proof. So in France, they don't have that differentiation. And in the States, they just double it. They make it really simple. 50% alcohol, I'll get this the wrong way around, is 100 proof. Or the other way around. So they just double it. Yeah, 50% alcohol, 100 proof. So they just simply doubled. So I did learn. So thank you very much, Robin, for pointing that out. I was meant to say that on bonfire night, because then we would have had the gunpowder link. So sorry that I missed that. Katie Jones rocks. Thanks very much. Yeah. I'm learning as well as we go along. It's just really fascinating. And then the distillery. So we were talking about the distillery in Touchon that worked up until about the 1970s and then closed down. And that used to take the skins and distill them. Today we take our skins into Ornaison. So that's another little village down the road. And Ornaison, I don't know if any of you know that village of Ornaison, but it's actually in the news this morning, the distillery, and that's because they've converted their process and they're actually making alcohol sanitizer, and they're doing extremely well. So whereas like last year, you know, a couple of years ago, it wasn't going too well for distilleries, now they're actually making alcohol-based hand sanitizer and they can't get enough skins to meet demand. So interesting facts, and they're doing a great job. Apparently there's only two distilleries in France that have actually mastered the technique of making the alcohol gel